Welcome to another presentation about the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. This presentation tries to reconstruct the shape of the ejecta curtain of an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide Ice Sheet that ejected pieces of ice in ballistic trajectories. The seismic vibrations of the oblique secondary impacts of glacier ice liquefied on consolidated soil and created inclined conical cavities that became shallow elliptical basins by viscous relaxation. A recent comment in one of my videos said, "It is a mildly interesting and kind of boring topic, but Mr. Zamora makes it utterly fascinating. Thank you." What? The Carolina Bays are boring? I'm glad that I can make the topic fascinating, but I have to contest the boring part. I replied, "Riding a train is also kind of boring until a cow gets in front of the tracks." In order to make this presentation more interesting, we are going to go back in time about 2,400 years. Aristotle was a Greek philosopher who lived from 384 to 322 years BC. His writings cover a broad range of subjects spanning natural sciences, philosophy, linguistics, economics, politics, psychology, and the arts. Aristotle related the four classical elements, earth, water, air, and fire, to four sensible qualities, hot, cold, wet, and dry. In this scheme, all matter was made of the four elements in different proportions, but Aristotle added the heavenly ether, the divine substance of the heavenly spheres, stars, and planets. Now, very quickly, we come back to the present and ask the question, how can we interpret the Carolina Bays in terms of Aristotelian philosophy? In ancient times, regular shapes were associated with sacred geometry. According to Aristotle, God caused the world to be as it is, and the spheres of the cosmos were a confirmation of this belief. From that point of view, the elliptical geometry of the Carolina Bays is a manifestation of sacred geometry. In ancient Greek religion, Zeus ruled as king of the gods on Mount Olympus. Of course, the Carolina Bays with their sacred geometry were made by Zeus. Good job, Zeus! Today, we are too skeptical to accept sacred geometry as a fact, and we look for laws of nature and mechanisms of formation that can give us a secular answer. The Aeolian lacustrine hypothesis proposes that the Carolina Bays were created by wind and water mechanisms. Aeolus, the god of the winds, blows over lakes and depressions filled with water. The wave action and the wind-blown sand build the raised rims and create geological features that have perfectly elliptical sacred geometry. But unlike Zeus, Aeolus does not guarantee perfection because the wind is very fickle. Thus far, no Aeolian experiment has consistently produced elliptical features. The thermokarst hypothesis proposes that the Carolina Bays are relict thermokarst lakes. These lakes form on ground that has permafrost, and when the underground ice melts, a sinkhole forms that fills with water. This hypothesis has several serious deficiencies. 1. Sinkholes don't have raised rims. 2. They are not mathematically elliptical. And 3. The bays in North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia are found on terrain that had no permafrost even during the last glacial maximum. The scientific analysis of the Carolina Bays requires measurements and calculations. We cannot just wave our hand and say that the bays developed through stronger than present southwesterly winds, or that they are thermokarst lakes while ignoring the permafrost evidence. Modern scientific analysis requires fitting ellipses to the Carolina Bays by the least squares method to show that they are conic sections. In this way, we know that the Carolina Bays originated as inclined conical cavities or penetration funnels. The width-to-length ratio of the bays is used to calculate the angle of impact. Ballistic equations determine the launch speed, the height of the trajectories, and the flight time of the projectiles. Equations relating energy to crater size are used to determine the size of the projectiles, and the density provides the mass of the projectiles. Using the mass and velocity, we can determine the kinetic energy of the impact that made each Carolina Bay. We also need to test with a physical model to make sure that the hypothesis is based on reality. This is a LiDAR image centered around Shannon, North Carolina. It is an area with many Carolina Bays examined and cataloged by Michael Davies and marked with red dots. Each of the four squares measures 10 kilometers on each side and has an area of 100 square kilometers. In order to reconstruct the shape of the ejecta curtain, my idea is to calculate the ballistic trajectories for all the bays in each 100 square kilometer area and then plot them to visualize them. In an earlier presentation, I plotted the trajectories of two projectiles that made overlapping bays in Marlboro County, South Carolina. The time of emplacement calculated using ballistic equations agrees with the law of superposition. In this case, the second impact occurred 35 seconds after the first one and partially overlaid it. Doing something similar for all the bays in an area of 100 square kilometers is a long and tedious process where the only reward is the final image. This is the LiDAR image of the first 100 square kilometer area to be studied. As you can see, a hailstorm of giant ice boulders really messes up the landscape. Many bays are highly eroded and we need a good plan. The main objective is to create a spreadsheet to record the information for each bay processed, including the bay ID, width, length, angle of impact, azimuth, distance from the origin, time of flight, maximum height, projectile size, and energy of emplacement. The bays in this square may not be sufficient to calculate the point of origin of a projectile. In this case, a convergence point adjusted for the Coriolis effect will be determined with the aid of the orientation of the Nebraska rainwater basins. Only bays whose center is inside the 100 square meter area and for which the width and length can be determined are selected. To test the idea, I selected 7 well-preserved Carolina bays in this area. I calculated the angles of impact from the width to length ratios of the bays and I also determined their azimuths. Extending the azimuths of these 7 Carolina bays, we find that their origin is at approximately the convergence point reported by Davies and Gilbride at a GSA meeting in 2010. Taking into consideration the Coriolis effect due to the eastward rotation of the Earth, the source of the ice projectiles that made the bays was probably in Lake Michigan, which was covered with ice during the Onaway Advance 12,900 years ago. From the ballistic equations for these 7 cases, we find that the shortest flight time of 6.8 minutes was for bay number 2, and the longest flight time of 8 minutes was for bay number 1. These bays were made 74.5 seconds apart. That is a difference of 1 minute and 14 seconds. We can see that bay number 2 is overlapping a highly eroded bay to its northwest, so it was not the first bay to form in this area. Estimating the projectile diameters to be about 1/5 of the length of the bays, we can calculate the kinetic energy of the impacts. Just these 7 impacts had a combined energy of 173 megatons of TNT. Similar calculations in Marlboro County, South Carolina, have yielded estimates of 8 megatons of TNT per square kilometer. The impacts that made the Carolina bays really packed the punch. We can now plot the trajectories for these 7 cases to see their profile, which corresponds to the shape of the ejecta curtain. The starting and ending points are approximately separated by a distance of 1,170 kilometers in all the cases. Most of the trajectories have heights between 200 and 240 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. There's only one trajectory that reached a height of 285 kilometers. The Earth's atmosphere extends only to 100 kilometers above the surface, so all the trajectories are suborbital space flights where a major portion of the flight is in the vacuum of space. The mathematical study of the Carolina bays can provide very detailed insights into the past. I'm here just to show you the way. I cannot do it all myself. This is a project that requires multi-generational organization and a lot of manpower, but it is possible. The end result will be a computer model that will show the pieces of ice, their trajectories, and their secondary impacts. After this model is built, we will start to truly comprehend what happened to the megafauna and the Clovis people that inhabited North America 12,900 years ago. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. There's a link to the LiDAR visualization tool in the description of the video. I will continue to examine the mechanisms that made the Carolina Bays one bay at a time. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.